Welcome to a presentation on Software Composition Analysis, SCA, as presented in Tech Hub's SoFlow DevCon and the Miami JVM Group Meetup, May 2024. Hi, my name is Eugenio Alvarez. I'm a South Florida software engineering professional, proponent of unit testing, and an advocate for agile engineering practices using Kanban and Scrum. Introduction. Market forces are driving companies to accelerate the development of secure software to gain a competitive advantage and avoid costly software breaches. The software development community has found that software composition analysis tooling can improve the competitive need for increased security and speed. Software composition analysis tooling provides an efficient way to reduce security threats from open source software components. We will discuss in this presentation the need for SCA to manage open source components, how CVEs and SBOMs are related to SCA, SCA tooling is a part of secure coding practice, the cybersecurity landscape that is requiring SCA, the need for software licensing management with SCA, and third-party risk management and SCA. We take a look here at the open source exposure. This is from Synopsys Open Source Security and Risk Report from 2024. Of the code bases analyzed, 96% contained open source. Troubling from the previous year is a 54% increase in high risk vulnerabilities that were found. 84% of the code bases contain vulnerabilities, and 74% of these code bases contain high risk vulnerabilities. So how much open source is in your projects? So we have here a meta-analysis from the Synopsys Black Duck Security and Risk Report. This is data from 2015 all the way to 2023, and we see during this time frame a very large increase in the average number of components with only a small dip in the previous year, the last year of the surveys. So why are so many open source components? With an average of 526, this is data coming from the Synopsys report, you can cross-reference with other data sources. In this case, we'll take a look at the Sonatype 9th annual state of the supply chain report coming from 2023, and it's saying that Java applications have an average of 148. So how do you match that 148? First off, it's not even really 148 because that's a total number of dependencies. The estimation is 90% of that is open source, so it's really about 130 something versus 526. So what's happening is there's an elephant in the room, and it's called JavaScript. The majority of the code that's out there today, what's been written in the last few years, is coming from JavaScript. And we have another data source from GitHub Octoverse report. This is from 2020, showing a median, not an average, but a median of 683 dependencies coming from a median of 10 direct. So from 10 direct, you get 683. And this basically skews the averages to have this. When you take a look at other programming languages like Java, C#, Ruby, and Python, you start seeing much smaller numbers, or very similar to the Java ecosystem, right? So this is what's called transitive dependencies. So when the initial application references, in this case, three, it's actually, when you count total, it's much more than three because of these dependencies are recursively being added, and they're being called transitive dependencies. So now we take a look, quote of a Chinese military strategist and general named Sun Tzu. And I'm quoting him to say, the invincibility lies in defense. This is Sun Tzu from The Art of War, which is a famous book. This fellow was 500 BC. Also another quote, thus what we do is of supreme importance is in war is to attack the enemy's strategy. And we are basically in a war with these hackers trying to compromise and do a security breach, right? So we take a look at the things that we need that we use in secure coding practices. In this case, Secure Coding Dojo, we use static application analysis testing, dynamic, and software composition analysis, among many other tools, but these are three primary drivers, right? And we're going to be focusing just on the software composition. So software composition analysis is not the end-all be-all. It's part of secure coding practices, right? SCA tools in action. We will see the identification of open source components, identify security issues. Now, the identification of open source components is not as simple as it may seem because of the nature of the way the packaging of software. It may not mean it readily apparent from the project what components are present. If there's a manager, a package manager, it's relatively easy, but still there's other components that are just copied in. So once you identify, you have to identify the open source issues and then identify any potential licensing issues. Notify and migrate open source issues, manage open source quality. There are tools out there that combine static application analysis with software composition analysis, and they're basically saying that there's a vulnerability or there isn't a vulnerability. Just a warning to be careful, false negatives. Dynamic code detection is the only way. Static analysis is not going to be able to find all this. So if static analysis finds a vulnerability, it's likely you actually have a vulnerability. But if it doesn't find one, it doesn't necessarily mean you don't have one, because again, only with dynamic code analysis, not static analysis, are you able to do that. So it's important not to take these with a grain of salt. So a lot of this is like, what's the big deal? It's just a simple update, maybe, maybe not. So we have several scenarios in where you're not gonna be able to easily upgrade. The majority of the time, yes, you're gonna be able to upgrade. In the case of H2, they decided to be backward incompatible on the database file. So when you do an upgrade, you have to recreate that database, right? Not a simple upgrade. In the case of JUnit, not a simple upgrade, which caused a lot of projects to stay in the version of JUnit 4. There's not an upgrade path. In the case of the Spring framework, lots of work associated with migrating from one version to the next, causing a lot of delays and a lot of issues to keep up. And the original versions of AngularJS, also a big change. Some projects like Apache Struts doesn't have an upgrade. And so we're still seeing projects based on Struts. They're still around that need to be migrated, but when the migration, it's not just a simple upgrade, it's basically rewriting the application. So now we talk about CVEs, common vulnerabilities and exposures. This is a list of publicly released known cybersecurity vulnerabilities issued by vendors and researchers. Each CVE has an identification number, identifier. The CVE does not include necessarily technical data. The databases of publicly disclosed CVEs, there are multiple of these. In the case of the United States, there's the NVD, National Vulnerabilities Database. And we take a look at the SBOMs. So the SBOMs are the software bill of materials. This is the first step in a software composition process, software composition analysis process, where you're identifying and then you're creating a list of the identified dependencies. So there's two main formats that are out there. Cyclone DX, which is machine readable, sponsored by OpenWASP. And then there's SPDX, Software Package Data in Exchange. It's an open standard, an ISO standard, sponsored by the Linux Foundation. Here's an example of SBOM. You can see that it has the author, the information associated with all the dependencies, and unique identifiers. And so what's going on here is why the SBOMs, we have usage surveys showing the increase in usage. We have SBOM adoption drivers, the Presidential Executive Order 14028 for cybersecurity. This was in 2021. An SBOM is part of the secure development. It is even specified in the executive order. She goes, so you have now issues now with regulatory compliance. You also have risk mitigation in the supply chain and customers that are asking for this now. So now we're taking a look at where SCA is used in the build pipeline. We'll see that in the developers inside their IDEs, when they have static analysis, they also have the ability to have plugins that will actually identify any components that are out of date and need to be updated. When you have the build process, you're also checking for SCA. In this case, in the build process, you may even ask it to stop the build if there's critical vulnerabilities, so that it can be addressed immediately. Then finally, you're also doing a scan on the container. So where the vulnerabilities are coming from, it's not just from the immediate source code, it's the source code plus the environment in which it's running in. And the container itself may have vulnerabilities, and that's why you do the SCA scan on the container, so you can find as the wide net as possible of these security issues. So we take a look at open source management licensing that's done by SCA. There's traditional licenses like the MIT, Apache, and BSD. These are fairly innocuous licenses in terms of business friendly. You can use these licenses. You may have some attribution necessary for these, and some others like GNU Lesser, GNU, you can use the code unmodified. If you modify, then you need to actually contribute and open source the project. The issue comes from conflicts with GNU GPL, which can cause quite a little bit of a little time bomb there. Why is that the case? Why does it cause this conflict? Because there's a thing called copyleft requirement, where any works using a GPL code must be distributed under GPL itself, right? Including the code of the derivative work. So examples of this are Linksys with their famous router and Samsung TVs, where in the case of Linksys, they had to actually release the source code per license, and it spawned a whole generation of open source based router firmware. We also have the issues associated with version management. Part of this from the synopsis report shows that there were an average of 10 versions, 91% were an average of 10 versions behind the current version. There's also data from another source from Cenotype showing how the retrieval from their repositories, in this case Maven Central, 96% of the components with known vulnerabilities could have been avoided by using a fixed version, right? So it's seeing that a lot of this retrieval is coming from these repositories of unpatched versions that could be patched. SCA tools recommend that. So now we have open source quality, and basically looking from the Sonotype report, we see that a lot of projects are not maintained. And when we're paying attention, we see which ones they are, and which one's a problem, which ones are not a problem. In this case, they're using an identifier. They're identifying projects, in this case, 18% stopped being used because they haven't been updated in a year. Now that depends on the project. Maybe that's okay. Maybe it's not okay, right? But relative to the project itself, once you're checking and maintaining with software composition analysis, you actually become aware of these things. This shows you what the software composition analysis tools can do. In the case is the pipeline in the bottom left, generating an SBOM and submitting it to the service. So the service doesn't need to know all your source code. It basically just looks at the dependency list in the SBOM, and then does the monitoring, pulls the data from the NVD and the other sources. If you have a third-party vendor, may use multiple sources, and then it can take that information and email, text, Teams, Slack, create tickets in the ticketing system, and even create a PR request, a pull request with fixes. This is in the case of GitHub. They bought a company, Dependabot, that actually did that, that actually generated a fix for libraries that are simple fix, which are the majority of them, just to keep it automated. It doesn't do the entire work, but it does the work of doing the change and then ask for a person to review it, right? So then we're getting now to the scanning of vendors software. Now, if you have an SBOM from a vendor, what you do is you just, and that's a recommended way of doing that, doing it is basically you upload it into your SCA tool and it has a 24-hour monitoring for your third-party vendor software, right? So this is the area of third-party risk management, TPRM. And this is coming from another source, the security scorecard. And it's basically saying 98% of organizations have relationships with a third party that have been breached. Third party breaches are the breaches that are originating from the third party technology. In this case, depending on the industry, it varies per percentage, but overall 29% of the breaches are coming from third parties. So traditionally, questionnaires were used to monitor these third parties, but ideally an SBOM would be retrieved and monitored 24/7 with SCA tooling so that you can immediately know that there's a vulnerability in one of the third parties to reduce the chances of a breach coming from the third parties. So we'll take now a quick look at some of the SCA tools. These are the, this from Synopsys, this is the IDE plugin where it shows the vulnerabilities. And we'll take a look at another open source project called Dependency Check, which is basically for your build pipeline, which shows you what the issues are at that point in time of the build. Right, so it's not continuous checking, but it basically at the time of a build, right? So this in itself is not enough because you need that 24-hour monitoring, but when you're doing the build, you can put a rule here, for example, to stop the build until the criticals, for example, are addressed. We also have an open source project from OWASP called Dependency Track, basically that does that 24/7 monitoring once the SBOM is uploaded. In this case, Dependency Track uses only Cyclone DX format, right? But the other third-party services would be using both SPDX and Cyclone DX, and it gives you a historical report about where the vulnerabilities are coming from, where the projects are, right? So that's nice to see what's going on. That's pretty much it about the software composition analysis. Thank you for viewing this presentation.